Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents When Washington Burned, The British Invasion of the Capital and a Nation's Rise from the Ashes by Robert P. Watson, narrated by Christopher Douyard. Bladensburg Races. James Madison, a soldier was, of courage and renown, and generalissimo was he, of famous Washington. Quoth Madison unto his dear, though frightened we have been these last two tedious weeks, yet we no enemy have seen. Tomorrow is the 24th, and much indeed I fear that then, or the following day, that Cockburn will be here. Tomorrow then, quoth she, we'll fly as fast as we can pour northward unto Montgomery, all in our coach and four. Preface. In his address to Congress in response to the attack on the U.S. naval base at Pearl Harbor, President Franklin Roosevelt announced to a shocked nation, yesterday, December 7, 1941, a date which will live in infamy, the United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan. Infamy, indeed. The raid sank or damaged 20 warships, destroyed hundreds of aircraft, and killed nearly 2,500 naval personnel while wounding over 1,000 more. The president's words called a stunned nation to arms, signaling America's entry into the war. But the bombing in Hawaii was not the first major assault on a U.S. territory, nor, tragically, would it be the last. Most Americans alive today remember all too vividly where they were on the morning of September 11, 2001, when 19 militants with the terrorist group Al-Qaeda hijacked four commercial aircrafts and used them to carry out suicide attacks against prominent targets on U.S. soil. Two planes struck the iconic World Trade Center in New York City. Another crashed into the west side of the Pentagon in the nation's capital, and it is believed that the fourth plane may have been headed to a nearby target, such as the Capitol building, until the passengers stormed the cockpit and brought it down in a field in Pennsylvania. Almost 3,000 people died in the attack, including 125 military and civilian personnel in the Pentagon, 343 firefighters and paramedics in New York City, 60 New York City police officers and Port Authority police, and all 265 aboard the four airliners. The Capitol building has not always been spared. It has seen its share of violence. Beyond antebellum-era assaults by some members of Congress, the past century saw attacks both on and at the Temple of Liberty. On July 2, 1915, a bombing was carried out by Eric Muntner, who was protesting American support for its allies in the Great War. On March 1, 1954, Puerto Rican nationalists shot and wounded five members of Congress. On March 1, 1971, the Weather Underground detonated explosives in the men's room below the Senate chambers. And in 1983, protesters against U.S. involvement in Grenada bombed the Capitol and other government sites in the city. More recently, on January 6, 2021, a few thousand angry supporters of the outgoing president, Donald Trump, gathered in the capital city at a so-called Save America rally. Stoked to a fever pitch by Trump's claims that the election was stolen by radical left Democrats, and his urging, "If you don't fight like hell, you're not going to have a country anymore," his supporters marched to the Capitol building. Hoping to overturn the results of the 2020 election and disrupt the efforts of a joint session of Congress to certify the final tally, they used flagpoles as weapons and overran the outnumbered police officers, breaching the building and occupying the Capitol. Amid threats to capture Democratic members of Congress and a chance of hang Mike Pence, the violent mob busted windows, broke doors, and ransacked the congressional offices and House chambers, even erecting makeshift gallows nearby. Five people died, either during or after the event, and well over 100 police officers were wounded. But long before this attack, the capital city itself was the target. It occurred during the War of 1812, when on August 24, 1814, the British invaded the United States and burned government buildings in Washington. A moment that can be said to have been America's first day of infamy. A dark and dismal day. The darkest and most dismal in all the American calendar, in the words of one chronicler of the attack. To be sure, perhaps no other single event in American history compares to the British capture of Washington in terms of sheer shock and the potential consequences for the survival of the nation. As the only real invasion of American soil by a foreign enemy, the British capture of Washington was a singular episode in the nation's story. Although a few burn marks can still be found on the original walls of the White House, Americans know little about the details of the attack. Textbooks and classrooms have paid little attention to the momentous incident. And questions remain about the rationale for the decision by British commanders, and the many mistakes made by American leaders during this critical chapter in history. To be sure, the events described in the chapters that follow constitute important hinges in American history, with the very future of the experiment in democracy hanging in the balance. On another level, it is an intriguing story, one that nearly ended the nation's independence, but instead ended up both shaping and strengthening the young republic. Few other moments in the nation's history were as potentially ruinous and consequential. In a campaign that unfolded over the course of just a few weeks, American forces would be embarrassingly routed outside of Washington. The president would narrowly avoid being killed or captured on the front lines of the fighting, and the British would invade the capital city itself, set the public buildings ablaze, and nearly capture the First Lady. With the future of the United States hanging in the balance, Baltimore would then be attacked by land and by water. But against all odds, a ragtag band of defenders would turn back the invading army, inspiring a poem that would become the national anthem. The campaign includes numerous cases of cowardice and incompetence by both the Madison administration and American military commanders who left the capital vulnerable to attack. However, it is also a story of inspired heroism and extraordinary acts of courage, such as when a few junior clerks risked their lives to save America's most treasured heirlooms from the flames. Perhaps the most momentous milestone of the invasion was that it threatened the very existence of the United States as a sovereign nation and sparked a debate over whether to rebuild or relocate the capital. Had the British marched with a larger force, or one with enough artillery, they may have been able to occupy and hold the seat of government. Had Baltimore fallen, as it nearly did, American morale, already teetering, may have led to the abandonment of the capital. In those respects, the conflagration is a coming-of-age story that ultimately prompted an unlikely rebirth of national identity and the remaking of American democracy. Not even General Robert E. Lee's surrender at Appomattox Courthouse, an act marking the end of the Civil War, produced a national consciousness and pride like that of the rebuilding of Washington. The conclusion of the Civil War failed to unite the North and South, left bitter sentiments among many Southerners, and led to thousands of former Confederates fleeing the country, rather than live under the American flag and a nation without slavery. Indeed, few other moments, save for the end of World War II in 1945 or the landing on the moon in 1969, did more to imbue Americans with a sense of national purpose. Yet, by then, the American nation and all of its attending democratic institutions had been established, in part owing to the rebirth of a sense of national identity produced from the momentous events of the year 1814. A note to listeners. You will occasionally notice awkward phrasing in some of the letters and reports quoted. However, in the name of historical integrity, I retained the original usage reflective of the time. Likewise, the White House was historically known as the Presidential Palace, the President's House, and the Executive Mansion. The contemporary name would have to wait until President Theodore Roosevelt began using it on stationery in 1901. Listeners will also note that each chapter opens with a verse. The lines are from the poem On the Conflagration of Washington, a popular work at the time by Philip Freneau, 1752 to 1832, who was known as the poet of the American Revolution. Prologue. The Sacking of York. Now, George III rules not alone, for George the Vandal shares the throne, true flesh of flesh and bone of bone. The war was going badly for the United States. Very badly. From the start, it was a misbegotten, haphazardly planned, and poorly executed affair, and perhaps one that never needed to happen in the first place. Its origins were equally perplexing, although many people at the time understood that the war was sparked by frequent British harassment of American shipping. For a decade, American sailors had been pressed into service in His Majesty's Navy. Eventually, the nation lost its patience with Britain, and in 1811 and 1812, war hawks in Congress, firebrands, mostly from the southern and frontier states, began to agitate for a declaration of war and an attack on British North America, the provinces of Upper and Lower Canada. They succeeded in pushing the nation into a conflict, then failed to fund the hostilities they sought. Meanwhile, in New England, where the war was unpopular because of commercial ties with Britain, there was even talk of secession. The rumblings increased after the region's economy collapsed from the trade embargo and the British blockade of the eastern seaboard. Consequently, some New England and mid-Atlantic states balked when asked to help finance America's invasion of Canada. Moreover, some of their militia units refused to cross the border to march on their neighbor to the north. Disturbingly, the war reopened ugly political and sectional fault lines that dated to the founding debates and exposed the American military as unprepared and many of its commanders as inept. A few were unmasked as cowards. President James Madison and his cabinet did not fare much better in their preparation for and management of the war. Accordingly, after several embarrassing defeats and debacles through the summer of 1812, a sense of desperation pervaded the nation and began to define the war effort. The news remained bad that August when the American general William Hull surrendered the city of Detroit, along with a key fort, to a small number of British regulars, Canadian militiamen, and Native Americans without a fight. Then, General William Henry Harrison's effort that fall into winter to retake the important town and fort on the northwestern frontier ran into trouble. Meanwhile, the Shawnee chief Tecumseh increased his indigenous confederacy's raids on American settlements and soldiers along the frontier. The failures in both the western and eastern theaters of the war continued, and by 1813, the Americans had yet to take Canada, despite several attempts and an overwhelming advantage in troop strength. Morale was plummeting among the army and state militias, and the war becoming increasingly unpopular with the public. The nation was sorely in need of a victory. It was in that urgent atmosphere that the Secretary of War, John Armstrong, a man unfit for the position, ordered General Henry Dearborn, an officer equally incompetent and derided by his own troops as granny, to again strike Canada. Inexplicably, Dearborn somehow remained in command of the new and important mission, despite having failed the year before. Planning took place in February 1813, and it was agreed the invasion would commence in spring. The focus would be on Upper Canada, present-day Ontario. The objective was to finally seize the region and change the complexion of the war. The target was now the port city of Kingston on the Canadian side of the Niagara River, a strategically important waterway flowing between Lake Erie and Lake Ontario. Control of the lakes, river, and bustling port was vital for subduing Canada. A force of roughly 4,000 troops was mustered for the invasion, composed largely of units from Sackett's Harbor, a port and naval yard on the New York side of Lake Ontario. The army was to be supplemented by 3,000 militiamen from nearby Buffalo. Half would head for Fort George and Fort Erie on the Canadian border, and the remaining force would sail for Kingston. As had so often been the case in the Young War, Dearborn dallied. Despite the fact that previous forays into Canada had generally met only minimal resistance, and the British had few soldiers in their northern colony, the hesitant general worried that the enemy might be amassing a large army along the Niagara. There was, however, absolutely no intelligence to corroborate his concern. On the contrary, the British were, at the very same moment, struggling to mount any kind of defense. President Madison and his war cabinet expressed frustration with Dearborn, but rather than replace him, issued new orders. He should instead strike York, present-day Ontario, nestled on the shores of Lake Ontario. It was an interesting decision, as York was far less significant from a military perspective, but presented a politically enticing yet sensitive target. It was the capital of Upper Canada. Although York served as the seat of government, it was a capital in name only. York had only about 600 residents, a few government buildings, and fewer defenses than the port of Kingston. This was good news for Granny Dearborn, who would have numerical superiority and needed a victory. The attack on the lakeside capital would be but the beginning of a larger mission, the tip of the spear of the invasion of Canada. After subduing York, the American Expeditionary Force would push through Upper Canada, taking towns, forts, and other strategic sites. The die would be cast for the fall of Canada. At least, that was the plan. Once again, however, the mission encountered logistical complications and gross incompetence. Fewer than 2,000 of the promised soldiers and only a few hundred sailors and Marines were ready for the assault. Nevertheless, Dearborn was told to proceed. What the general did have were capable officers to implement the actual attack. Captain Isaac Chauncey would lead the naval element of the invasion. Born in 1772 in Connecticut, the seasoned U.S. Navy veteran had gone to sea at the age of 12 and was commanding his own ship by 19. Chauncey's distinguished career included overseeing construction on the USS President, one of the renowned six frigates of the fledgling American fleet. He would go on to serve on the President, as well as on the illustrious USS Constitution. In a vote of confidence, Chauncey was given command of all naval operations on Lake Ontario, including Sackett's Harbor. The promotion was owed to his skill as a shipbuilder. He immediately proceeded to do what was expected of him: build warships. Chauncey's fleet would transport Dearborn's forces across the lake to York. From there, the ground attack would be in the hands of a new brigadier general, Zebulon Pike. Though born in New Jersey, Pike would spend much of his career exploring the American West, including as a member of expeditions to chart the Mississippi River to its source, map the rivers and trails of the Rocky Mountains, and identify the source of the Red River. Tempered by numerous trials, possessing an even disposition, and having the respect of his otherwise unruly troops, the 34-year-old general was the man for the job. Pike's presence also meant that Dearborn could remain on the ship, out of the way, and unable to muck up the invasion, at least the initial attack. Chauncey's flotilla of 14 ships prepared to ferry Pike's army from Sackett's Harbor to York on April 22, 1813. But poor weather ominously delayed the operation. 4 days later, conditions improved, and the troops boarded the ships and sailed for the Canadian shoreline, roughly 160 miles away. Emotions on the ships would have been as high as the stakes. There had been embarrassing defeats the previous year. Political pressure was building to secure a victory, and the target was now the capital city. As York came into view on April 26th, it was apparent to Dearborn, Chauncey, and Pike that, other than one fort, there was little standing between them and victory. Seizing the capital city would be the kind of symbolic blow that could transform the war. The night before the assault on York, Pike penned a letter to his father. In it, the general wrote, "Should I be the happy mortal destined to turn the scale of war, will you not rejoice, O my father? May heaven be propitious and smile on the cause of my country." Unlike some of his vain and aloof fellow commanders, the general spoke of the unoffending citizens of Canada who have been forced into this war, and noted empathetically that many of them are our own countrymen. Importantly, Pike had no plans to attack civilians or private property, just military targets and government buildings. He wanted it to be an honorable campaign. He also added prophetically, "But if we are destined to fall, may my fall be like Wolfe's, to sleep in the arms of victory." the flotilla arrived around sunrise on April 27th. The amphibious assault began moments later and was covered by the naval guns on Chauncey's flagship, the USS Madison. While the fleet bombarded the fort, three full regiments quickly made it ashore. Inside the fort, General Roger Chaffe stood little chance. His only defense ended up being the strong winds that kicked up on the water, causing a few of the landing craft to be blown off course and come ashore some distance from the main army. The defenders acted. One group of boats came under fire by Britain's Indian allies hiding on the shoreline. Intense musket fire hindered the landing and threatened to turn the boats away. However, this countermeasure only delayed the inevitable. Chauncey ordered his naval guns to target the Indian defenders. The powerful artillery bombarded the beach and drove the Indians from the coast. All but a handful of the landing craft were now on shore. Chaffe made the mistake of not striking when the enemy's initial landing craft were still in the water, and thus most vulnerable. Instead, he kept the majority of his men inside the fort. It would be his undoing. The final companies landed safely on the Canadian shoreline, albeit a short distance from the landing zone. The first phase went largely according to plan and with relative ease. The Americans were ashore and protected by powerful naval guns. Chaffe was now at a serious disadvantage in several ways. Most obviously, he was outnumbered. The small fortress was garrisoned by just 700 men, many of whom were recent militia recruits. They were supported by only about 50 to 100 fighters from the Ojibwe tribe, and there were no reinforcements in the region. Chaffe was also relatively new to the command, having replaced the legendary General Isaac Brock after his death at the Battle of Queenstown Heights a few months earlier. Chaffe was certainly no Brock in the minds of his men and Indian allies. Moreover, the British general had been ill all winter, and as a result, had not trained his troops or prepared his defenses. Chaffe did have three batteries positioned on the shoreline to repel any invasion. However, their construction was incomplete. The earthworks around the city and fort were also sparse and still under construction at the time of the invasion, and the fort's cannons were old. A few lacked ammunition. Accordingly, some of Chaffe's Indian allies, more loyal to the late Brock than to the British, recognized the futility of the situation and abandoned the battlefield. It was time to commence the main attack. Pike ordered his army of roughly 2,700 men to strike the fort and port. The ground assault progressed quickly from the beachhead through the high dunes and trees toward the fort, all the while supported by naval gunfire from Chauncey's warships. The broadsides from the fleet proved deadly accurate, pummeling the fort, destroying the few defensive batteries that were operational, and pinning down the British inside the fort. Pike's men were soon at the ramparts. They encountered little return fires from the walls of the fort above them. Rather, under the constant rain of artillery, Chaffe's local militiamen began to panic and flee for the cover of the thick inland forests. Amid the chaos, Chaffe ordered a retreat, affirming the suspicions of many in Britain who considered him unfit. The staunchly anti-American hardliners in Britain were always suspicious of his Boston-born parents, even though they were loyalists. The invaders began breaching the outer walls of the fort, turning Chaffe's retreat into a disorderly frenzy. Fearing for their lives, civilians streamed out of the town. During the chaos, the Americans captured many militiamen, who surrendered without a fight, while the general fled so quickly that he committed a cardinal military sin. The Union Jack still flew above the fort, greeting the invaders as they entered. Only a few local militiamen remained at the fort with hasty instructions from Chaffe to surrender and seek reasonable terms from the Americans. When the enemies rushed into the fort, these militiamen simply dropped their weapons. Just as the fighting was winding down and the Americans were securing the fort and town, one of the cannonballs fired from the fleet struck the main ammunition depot inside the walls, igniting the ordnance. The resulting explosion was so powerful that it flattened trees around the fort and was heard on the other side of the river. Fort York's wooden palisade was blown apart, and a gaping hole now sat where the munitions had been stored. At least 20 of the defenders, and even more Americans, were killed on the spot, Nearby, local townsfolk were knocked to the ground from the concussion blast, and anyone inside the fort who remained alive suffered hearing loss. Outside the fort, General Pike watched in disbelief as timbers, rocks, and bodies were flung high into the air. The explosion was so powerful that it also dislodged a massive boulder and sent it hurtling, as if launched by a medieval trebuchet. The timing of the explosion would prove disastrous in another way. Pike was sitting on a tree stump outside the fort, interrogating a captured Canadian militiaman who stood beside him. "What is your whole strength, and where are your regulars?" he asked the general. The militia sergeant was defiant, answering only, "I am a British soldier." Pike had hoped to obtain information that would allow him to expedite the conquest of the fort and minimize casualties, but his prisoner repeatedly refused to answer questions. In a bizarre coincidence, the giant rock arched up and over the fort and came down squarely on top of Pike and the British sergeant, killing them both instantly. The remaining Canadian militiamen either surrendered or melted away into the woods. It was a devastating defeat for the British and Canadians. They suffered nearly 100 killed and over 100 wounded, and 300 members of the local militia were either missing or captured. Ingloriously, their general ran, and the capital was now in the hands of the enemy, who would soon prove to be anything but honorable in victory. After the explosion, the Americans took stock of the damage. The scene was one of utter destruction. The blast deeply scarred the landscape. Trees, parts of the fort, bodies, and debris radiated outwards for hundreds of yards in every direction. Throughout the fort, American soldiers lay dead or dying. A surgeon tending to the wounded reported that he waded in blood, cutting off arms, legs, and trepanning heads. The carnage was such that the surgeon cut and slashed for 48 hours without food or sleep. It was a tarnished victory. There were more casualties from the explosion than from the actual fighting. Over 50 Americans died in the explosion, and another 265 were wounded. Unfortunately, the stern orders Pike issued to refrain from plundering the capital or harassing civilians were ignored. Pike had been determined to be the American general to finally take Canada, and unlike his predecessors, to do it with honor. However, with the loss of Pike, operational command was left to the inept Dearborn. After much delay, Dearborn, who had remained behind on the Madison, finally came ashore when the fighting ended. He could have let down his foes lightly, or seized the moment to treat the local population with charity. He did neither. Rather, upset by the loss of Pike, shocked by the explosion, and embarrassed by his inability to locate General Chafe, Dearborn's terms of surrender were a disgrace. Moreover, Dearborn and Chauncey had hoped to capture the HMS Sir Isaac Brock, the pride of the British fleet on the lake, but it was burned by quick-thinking sailors while the Americans were preoccupied with the fort. Nor did Dearborn press his advantage by pursuing Chafe and his vanquished army, or take advantage of the element of surprise to quickly seize nearby forts, towns, and other strategic targets. Instead, he devoted himself to punishing the residents and defenders of the conquered town. Dearborn remained in York that night, then extended the time spent in the capital city to 5 days. The result was that the army grew restless, with little to do. Not only did Dearborn fail to control his army, but he instigated much of the destruction that was to come. The day after the explosion, he took Chafe's personal belongings and parliamentary mace, then ordered that the British commander's residence be burned. He later put both military and government buildings to the torch. The Americans began looting. They ransacked St. James Church, the town library, and any remaining government buildings. Soon, the rampage turned to pillaging private property, sacking the city, and burning the parliament buildings. With much of the village in flames, residents, including women and children, were put out into the streets. The pillaging was justified on the grounds that it was payback for the British raid earlier that winter on Ogdensburg, a village along the St. Lawrence River. which itself was a reprisal for the looting that occurred at the hands of American raiding parties into Canada led by Major Benjamin Forsyth that February. Both sides were seeking revenge in the escalating series of reprisals that ended with the Americans burning York. There were those who celebrated the sacking of York as a grand victory, including some American newspapers, and the Southern and Frontier Warhawks who had sought both war and Canada. In private, members of President Madison's administration fumed. Dearborn, they complained, mishandled the victory by allowing Chafe to escape and York to be put to the torch. Grumbled Armstrong, the new Secretary of War, how could the remainder of Chafe's army be permitted to escape today that it may fight us tomorrow? The Secretary also held Dearborn personally responsible for the barbarous conduct of the American troops and failure to locate and seize British ships at York. Yet only a minor reprimand of Dearborn was forthcoming from the administration, and shockingly, despite all the bluster, Madison and Armstrong allowed him to remain in command. Thus was the state of the U.S. military at the time. The British and Canadians would not forget the burning of York. There would be consequences. Part 1. The Chesapeake Campaign. Chapter 1. The Silliest Damned War. Like Danes of old, their fleet they man, and rove from Beersheba to Dan, to burn and beard us where they can. President Harry Truman was never one to mince words. Thus, he bluntly described the War of 1812 as the silliest damn war we ever had. At the time it was fought, it was often referred to as Mr. Madison's War, a disparaging reference to the president, though he actually tried to avoid the conflict. It was but one of many ironies of the war. Quite simply, the War of 1812 was a quixotic and curious affair. It was a war that lasted 2.5 years, but was named for only one of them. It was seen by its supporters as America's second war for independence. After all, had the Americans lost, they may have been subjugated again by the British. On the other hand, had the Americans won, it is possible Canada would have become part of the United States. However, in the end, the affair was a costly and complicated tie. And despite the bloodshed and ill will, both the Canadian-American border and relations between the British and the Americans remained virtually unchanged. Although the fighting during the first 2 years of the conflict was, for the most part, restricted to the border between the two countries, it was a continental war. Armies regularly crossed the Canadian border, sailed up and down the Niagara and St. Lawrence rivers, and battled on Lakes Champlain, Erie, and Ontario. Hostilities extended to the American Northwest at Lakes Huron and Michigan, southeast to the Chesapeake Bay, and as far south as the mouth of the mighty Mississippi River. On the seas, warships prowled the waters off the coasts of the Azores and Ireland in the eastern Atlantic, Brazil in the western Atlantic, Cuba in the Caribbean, and even the far reaches of the uncharted Pacific Ocean. It was a war fought by inexperienced and poorly provisioned soldiers on both sides. To supplement the insufficient numbers, the Americans relied on militia units that often proved to be undisciplined, unruly, and ultimately unreliable. The war's violence and mismanagement periodically spilled over into civilian populations, as would be the case during the attack on Washington. Throughout the war, commercial ships were sunk, villages sacked, and unarmed locals harassed. British warships along the Chesapeake and nearby rivers repaid the sins, purposely targeting towns and farms with their naval guns. On the frontier, native populations were slaughtered. In turn, surrendering soldiers were massacred by Indian warriors. Such behavior marred any glory that might be gained in the fight. One of the tragic casualties of the war was the impact on indigenous peoples. Native American nations, often in conflict with one another and divided over their loyalties to the two warring powers, found themselves caught in the middle. As hostilities spread westward, entire Indian nations were either pushed off ancestral lands or forced to pick sides. Some advocates for American expansionism speculators eager to develop the West, and war hawks in the South used the war as political cover to advocate even more aggressive actions. President Thomas Jefferson and his successor James Madison, who took office in 1809, sought to avoid war with the British. This was a wise position, for America was not ready for war. Yet, neither president had prepared for such a contingency. Unforeseen events, shifting political winds, and costly missteps would negate their efforts. As the historian Alan Taylor has noted, British rule in Canada was intended to send a message to those south of the border to demonstrate the superior stability and prosperity that eventually would entice the rebel Americans to forsake their republican experiment. It thus seemed inevitable that two rival political systems could not long endure in a peaceable state on the same continent, much less along their shared, tenuous, and temporary border. Indeed, imbued with great confidence after defeating Napoleon's Grand Army on April 6, 1814, and impatient with America's repeated attempts to invade her Canadian colony in 1812 and 1813, the British would be eager to teach the upstart Americans a bloody lesson. One of the main causes of the war was impressment, which is the act of forcing sailors into service. It was on everyone's mind in the years before the War of 1812. Because of the continent-wide war with France, the British were reliant on their navy. France may have had the most powerful army in Europe, but the British navy was the master of the seas. Britain would use its navy to thwart Napoleon, but to do so meant the country was desperately in need of more ships and more sailors. It could build ships courtesy of the vast forests of Canada, which made its North American colony even more important. But it still needed more sailors. Britain viewed no country as neutral in its war with Napoleon, and arrogantly believed that once a subject of the king, always a subject of the king. There was no leaving the navy, for instance, to become an American. The Royal Navy, therefore, maintained it had the right to intercept ships on the high seas, and both seize cargo and press sailors into service, whether they were British sailors who abandoned His Majesty's service for the better pay and less rigid discipline aboard American ships, or whether they happened to be New England fishermen or sailors aboard merchant craft. Although records are unreliable, in the years leading up to the war, perhaps as many as 12,000 Americans may have been pressed into service on British warships. Communities were losing more than sons, brothers, and fathers to impressment. They were losing patience with the British. Tensions between the two nations had also been escalating over Britain's policy of inciting Indian raids on the American frontier. Reprisals for further encroachment on Indian lands were to be expected, but the Indians were often backed by British arms supplied from His Majesty's forts along the northwestern border with Canada. So too did the Indian raids limit America's ability to expand westward. Such animosities had been brewing since the conclusion of the American Revolution. The British continued many of these provocative policies in order to sustain their empire through coercive energy. Likewise, tensions festered in Canada, which Britain fully intended to retain. For example, soon after America gained independence, the British expelled some Americans who had been living in Canada, even as they accepted loyalists fleeing the United States, and developed what Taylor deemed a counter-revolutionary regime in Canada. But in the intervening years, many Americans moved north, to the extent that some British commanders in Canada worried that loyalties in Canada would be divided, that these recent immigrants would welcome the invasion from the south, and even join the fight. Meanwhile, some Americans held on to Canada fever, angry that Britain still controlled the vast expanse of land to the north. The causes were varied. Some American leaders worried that the British might try to reconquer the United States from Canada. Others were upset that Britain had delayed by a decade its agreement to withdraw from outposts along the American side of the Great Lakes. Some American leaders, many of them in the South, felt that Canada should have properly been part of the United States from the beginning. It was in the American South and on the Western frontier, the regions least affected by the trade restrictions and maritime impressment, where the real passion for both Canada and war was building. As tensions mounted and the nation stumbled toward war, the final pieces of the puzzle were put in place during the midterm elections of 1810. That election brought to power a group of young firebrands who showed little interest in the institutions of government, cooperating with senior members of Congress, or the politics of civility and compromise. Most were born after the Declaration of Independence, lacked military experience, and failed to show any deference to the wisdom of the revolutionary generation. They also played on fears and passions while ignoring voices of reason and peace. A wounded sense of national pride and anger were fanning a nascent sense of national identity, unfortunately, in a dangerous way. In the words of the scholar of the capital city, Kenneth Bowling, a mix of Anglophobia and hyperpatriotism factored into their advocacy for war. The self-proclaimed war hawks were led by Henry Clay of Kentucky and John C. Calhoun of South Carolina. Backed by their caucus of newly elected rabble-rousers, these two freshmen rose rapidly to power, promoting a reckless agenda of blood and expansionism. With tragic consequences, they were obsessed with war and seizing Canada, while dismissing the sage advice of war heroes and more experienced leaders. The national debate soon devolved into the false analogy of preferring war with all its accompanying evils to abject submission. If you were not with us, you were against us. Some Americans, including the former president Thomas Jefferson, though he opposed the war, and Congressman Clay, naively believed an invasion of Canada would be but a matter of the American military marching north. With bravado, some of Clay's fellow Kentuckians even boasted that the state's militiamen would defeat the British simply by showing up. They were wrong. Clay and many of his fellow warhawks also saw the invasion as the first step in a larger agenda involving American expansion, the spread of slavery, and the subduing of native populations. The toxic political atmosphere of the time between the Federalists and the Jeffersonian Republicans, also known as the Democratic Republicans, further precluded a rational and unified approach to the pending international problem, as the new Republicans were often obstructionists to Federalist leaders such as John Adams and Alexander Hamilton. Factions turned into parties, which turned into enemies. As Jefferson boasted in a letter to William Duane, "I will not say our party. The term is false and degrading, but our nation will be undone, for the Republicans are the nation." With that mindset, his fellow Republicans labeled the anti-war Federalists traitors. Republicans did not allow the Federalists to participate in debates or governance, especially surrounding the coming war. This bitterness only worsened as the war started and raged and extended to military appointments and strategy. As Taylor has noted, the dominant party monopolized the coveted commissions as officers. Elbridge Gerry echoed many of his fellow Republicans when he opposed allowing Federalists to receive commissions as senior officers, even though the military was understaffed and desperately in need of qualified commanders. Said Gerry, commissioning members of the opposing party would retard the recruiting service, give a triumph to the opposers of the national government, depress its friends, and weaken their confidence in the national army. Attitudes toward war were a different matter in the Northeast. Most American sailors affected by Britain's misguided naval policies hailed from New England. Yet the war's early rallying cry, free trade and sailors' rights, failed to move many New Englanders to arms. New Englanders remained opposed to the war because of economic ties with Britain. Northern and New England merchants and shippers continued to try to trade with Britain and Canada. Some northern politicians also saw Napoleon as a greater threat than the British. His appetite for war and expansion seemed inexhaustible. The emperor, after all, was believed to have designs on the Americas. Therefore, Britain might have been the only thing keeping the ambitious dictator from reacquiring the Louisiana Territory, the West, and Canada. Some northerners, therefore, opposed the war on grounds that Britain was the lesser of the two evils. So for 17 days in the month of June in 1812, Congress hotly debated President James Madison's declaration. Americans were divided as to their views on the coming war, insofar as it might be said that many Federalists and Northeasterners were Anglophiles, while many Jeffersonian Republicans and Southerners were Anglophobes. civility and dialogue broke down, replaced by factionalism and even name-calling. The president, who stood only 5 feet 4 inches, was decried as a pygmy by both pro-war and anti-war factions because of his moderation. Amid growing north-south, eastern seaboard, western frontier, and Federalist-Republican fault lines, and without much in the way of planning, the Warhawks carried the vote for war. The debate was bitter and divided, but Britain's depredations against the neutral United States at sea and affronts to American settlement on the northwestern frontier tipped the scale. On June 17, 1812, the U.S. Senate approved a resolution declaring war on Great Britain by a vote of 19-13. The next day, the House of Representatives voted 76-45 for war, with 18 members not voting. Not a single Federalist in the House voted for the war. And war came. The uncertain president had been pushed into a war he had not sought. Said Henry Adams, the noted 19th century historian, "Many nations have gone to war in pure gaiety of heart, but perhaps the United States were first to force themselves into a war they dreaded, in the hope that the war itself might create the spirit they lacked." There would be a total of 13 invasions back and forth across the border by the two warring sides. Yet, after 2 years of folly and fighting, in which both sides took their lumps, the war reverted to the status quo ante. The border remained largely unchanged in the Treaty of Ghent that concluded the conflict. It was America's economy and social fabric that were changed. Merchants, shippers, and entire coastal communities lost trade because of the British blockade of the eastern seaboard, while towns along the border were plundered by British raiders. Political rifts between those for and against the war deepened and further undermined the political support for the war and America's ability to equip its armies. Proposals to end the war began in earnest in New England. Something else had happened to change the complexion of the war in 1814. Neither its large colony across the Atlantic nor the looming war had been priorities for the British. Many Britons still believed America's grand experiment in republican government would end bitterly and inevitably in failure, whether they invaded or not. This was fortunate for the zealous American militiamen who were, for a time, able to avoid the full attention of His Majesty and the might of the British war machine. From 1812 to 1814, the British were forced to fully mobilize in Europe in order to defeat Napoleon. For the British military, the vastly more serious conflict was much closer to home, on the continent. The defense of Canada and the American sideshow had to wait. Although the French emperor had appeared to be unstoppable, he was ultimately defeated, at least for the time being. In 1814, the Napoleonic Wars finally ended, when the combined armies of Russia, Prussia, and Austria marched on France from the east, and Wellington's army on the Iberian Peninsula dealt France a stinging defeat and then pivoted to threaten France from the south. The emperor was forced to abdicate, and the threat to Europe appeared to be over. The British were able to turn their full attention to the pesky Americans. It was a worst-case scenario for the United States. Rather than merely reinforce the beleaguered Canadian troops in the defense of their northern colony, the British sent a large army to invade the United States. The war was about to come to America's front door. American forces were now forced into a defensive posture. Furthermore, after enjoying numerical superiority through much of the war, the Americans would now be facing a larger army of battle-hardened veterans, the forces that had defeated Napoleon's Grand Armée, and led by capable commanders. The United States was now facing the prospect of invasion and destruction, and the future of both the nation and its capital hung in the balance. Chapter 2. A Fateful Decision. They say at George IV's command, this vagrant host were sent to land and leave in every house a brand. The late summer of 1814 was brutally hot. Locals claimed it was the hottest and driest in memory. The sweltering temperatures left the roads dusty, the air parched, and the residents of the Chesapeake Bay region lethargic. The weather was not the only problem. The British Navy had been harassing coastal communities along the bay and its adjoining rivers for months. The British were also suffering from the heat, to which they were unaccustomed, unless they served in Spain, a problem compounded by their heavy woolen uniforms. One of the Americans minding both the weather and the movements of the British was General William Henry Winder, the newly appointed commander of the newly created 10th Military District, which encompassed the capital city and the Chesapeake region, worried that the enemy would not be content attacking small coastal towns indefinitely. They might shift their focus to a larger target. On July 9th, Winder drafted a letter to the governors of the surrounding states, Maryland, Pennsylvania, and Virginia, stating, "The enemy's fleet has now spent more than a 12-month in the waters of the Chesapeake, and during that time has visited almost every river falling into the bay." He warned that reports indicated reinforcements were sailing from England. When fresh troops joined the naval forces already on the bay, it must be presumed, he cautioned, that the combined force will proceed with the utmost promptitude and dispatch to their ultimate targets. "Should Washington, Baltimore, or Annapolis be their object?" asked the general. "What possible chance will there be of collecting a force, after the arrival of the enemy, to interpose between them and either of those places?" Winder promptly requested that each state send a few thousand of its militiamen for the defense of the region. He also petitioned the War Department, asking, "Would it not then be expedient to increase the force of my command?" Just over 1 month after Winder's warning, a powerful British force landed in Maryland and began marching to Washington. There were many reasons for the British to invade the American capital. They had been planning to attack the United States for months, and remembered all too well that the year before, the Americans had attacked the capital of Upper Canada. After the Americans destroyed York in 1813, Sir George Prevost, His Majesty's Governor General of Canada, wrote to Admiral Alexander Cochrane at his headquarters in Bermuda. In the letter, he advocated retaliatory measures, but couched his request in political language. In consequence of the late disgraceful conduct of the American troops and the wanton destruction of private property on the north shores of Lake Erie, an order that, if the war with the United States continues, you may, should you judge it advisable, assist in inflicting that measure of retaliation which shall deter the enemy from a repetition of similar outrages. Destroying a seat of government was strategic as well, in that it could cripple command and control capabilities while opening a psychological front designed to terrorize or humiliate the American people. Seizing a national capital was also a powerful form of propaganda that might undermine the young republic, sow further discontent among the war's critics, and prompt the Americans to settle for peace on terms favorable to Britain. At the same time, the conflagration may have been a way for Britain to exorcise any demons remaining from the loss of her former colonies during the Revolution. The man charged with the new campaign against the Americans was Vice Admiral Sir Alexander Inglis Cochrane. The son of the 8th Earl of Dundonald, Cochrane was born in Scotland in 1758. Preferring a life of adventure over one of privilege and comfort, he joined the Royal Navy as a young boy. His subsequent career involved extensive service, including in the Napoleonic Wars. While fighting the French and Spanish in those wars, Cochrane had a close call when a cannonball took off his captain's hat while he stood on the bridge of his flagship, HMS Northumberland, during the Battle of San Domingo. The Scot was knighted for his service to the crown and rose to the heights of power in the Royal Navy. He had the distinction, for instance, of being the first to sail into the famous Egyptian harbor of Alexandria when it fell in 1801. Cochrane was a legendary but complicated naval commander who served during the American War of Independence. He was thus familiar with both America and Americans. In 1805, he was given command of the Barbados and Leeward Island stations, which meant he was charged with protecting His Majesty's possessions and trade interests in the West Indies. In 1810, he was named Royal Governor of Guadeloupe. In these official capacities, Cochrane took a keen interest in Florida, New Orleans, and the Gulf of Mexico. As early as the time of his appointment in Guadeloupe, Cochrane began discussions with the Admiralty about seizing or asserting influence over the Gulf and America's southern coast. And he had longed for revenge since the upstart Americans won their independence from Britain 3 decades earlier. In fact, the confident commander boasted that the capital city might be possessed without difficulty or opposition of any kind. Little did he know how prophetically accurate he would be. In January 1814, Cochrane communicated with the Admiralty and Lord Bathurst about the need for a large amphibious force to expand the attacks farther inland. Targets included Boston, New York, and Philadelphia in the north, and Alexandria, Annapolis, Baltimore, Georgetown, and Norfolk in the Chesapeake region. Some consideration was also given to Washington. Yet, interestingly, the capital was not the main priority. Two of the leading proponents were Henry Bathurst, the Crown Secretary of State for War for the Colonies, and the Duke of Wellington, the hero of the Napoleonic Wars, who would later twice serve as Prime Minister. They proposed a grand expedition, comprising a force numbering 20,000 that would strike the American coast, with particular interest in New Orleans. Cochrane requested a quantity of combustible material for the mission so that he could burn ships, wharfs, blockhouses, etc. He also wanted his force to include veterans of Wellington's campaigns against Napoleon. Therefore, they would have perhaps the best trained and most effective fighting force in Europe. Confidence ran high in London. As the early plans evolved, the focus would be on naval operations on the New England and Chesapeake coasts. However, as the overall commander in the American campaign, Cochrane remained interested in the Gulf of Mexico and New Orleans, noting, "Whoever has possession of the mouth of the river, the Mississippi, must have the inhabitants of the interior more or less under his control." In addition, there were riches in the city to be plundered and advantages in trade. On April 1, 1814, Cochrane was named Commander-in-Chief of His Majesty's North American Station. He would oversee all North American operations, setting sail at the fore of an impressive flotilla of warships and supply vessels from his base in Bermuda. The 56-year-old's destination was the Chesapeake Bay. Cochrane's second-in-command was Rear Admiral Sir George Cockburn. Like his direct superior, he was born to privilege in 1772 in London and given the title 8th Baronet. Also like Cochrane, Cockburn had joined the Navy at a young age. After a career at sea and numerous battles in the West Indies and the Napoleonic Wars, he was recommended by none other than the famed Lord Horatio Nelson, who admired his officer's zeal, ability, and courage. The 42-year-old admiral was an experienced and capable, but hot-tempered, commander. The question remained as to who would command Cochrane's land campaign. The noted commander, Sir John Hope, was recommended for the task. However, in a skirmish near Toulouse that April, Hope was wounded and taken prisoner. The high command then turned to Sir Rowland Hill, a favorite of Lord Wellington and of the troops, who affectionately referred to him as Daddy. But Hill was hesitant to go to America, which he saw as a backwater and a demotion, especially after the honor of fighting Napoleon in Europe. A few other senior generals and veteran commanders of the Napoleonic Wars were considered, including General Edward Pakenham, brother-in-law of the Duke of Wellington, and Sir Henry Clinton, commander-in-chief of North America during the Revolutionary War. The problem was that most commanders shared Hill's view about being assigned to America. Moreover, after so many years of service against Napoleon, several generals longed to return home. Even Pakenham, who would later be enticed to lead the assault on New Orleans, originally quipped, "I think I have escaped America, and shall consider myself vastly fortunate in having been spared from such a service." Simply put, there was no glory in the North American campaign. The British turned to a few junior commanders and new generals, who might see it as both duty and an opportunity for command. One of them was Robert Ross. Ross was born in 1766 in Ross Trevor, County Down, Ireland. Interestingly, the man who designed and built the building now known as the White House, James Hoban, and the man who would soon burn it, Robert Ross, grew up not far from one another in Ireland. Ross's maternal family came from money, and his father served as an officer in the French and Indian Wars in America. After being educated at Trinity College in Dublin, he he followed his father into uniform, joining the 25th Regiment of Foot in 1789. Ross had gone on to fight in numerous campaigns during the Napoleonic Wars, serving in the Netherlands, in the Battle of Alexandria in Egypt, in the Italian campaign, and in the Peninsular War, where he was an officer under the famed Duke of Wellington, who later recommended him for the American campaign. He quickly gained a reputation for bravery and thoughtfulness on the battlefield, but nearly died in February 1814 during the Battle of Orthez in France when he was shot in the neck. Still nursing that serious wound, Ross contemplated an early retirement in order to be with his wife, Elizabeth, and children. However, when he recovered, the dashing 48-year-old officer was promoted to general and placed in charge of the ground forces for Cochrane's Chesapeake campaign. The aggressive and ill-tempered Cockburn bristled at Ross being given primary responsibility for the ground attack, although the two found a way to work together during the invasion. If anything, their very different views on the war and approach to combat contributed to some of the British successes in 1814. Where Ross was known as an even-keeled commander who was revered by his men, Cockburn was known for his intimidating presence and temper, and was more feared than admired by most who encountered him. The American army was about to face two experienced commanders, Ross and Cockburn, who had apprenticed under Britain's two.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.